Good evening. So we will now get started with tonight's program. Thank you for joining us as we welcome Emily Wilcox, Associate Professor of Chinese Studies at William & Mary. My name is Ariel Fox. I'm an Assistant Professor of Chinese Literature in the Department of East Asian Languages and Civilizations and the Committee on Theater and Performance Studies at the University of Chicago. The Center for East Asian Studies at the University of Chicago is an interdisciplinary nexus, clearinghouse, and resource for academic exploration and support related to the study of China, Japan, and Korea. For more information on CEAS and to subscribe to receive weekly outreach emails pertaining to future events sponsored by the center, please click on the links that will be provided in the chat box. Before I introduce our guest speaker, I'd like to remind everyone about tonight's Q&A session that will follow tonight's presentation. To ask a question, please be sure to type in your questions into the Q&A box, which you can do at any point during the presentation. Emily Wilcox is Associate Professor of Chinese Studies in the Department of Modern Languages and Literatures at William & Mary, and an affiliate of the Lieberthal-Rogel Center for Chinese Studies at the University of Michigan. Professor Wilcox is a leading scholar of Chinese dance and performance with broader interests in 20th century global history, transnationalism, and social movements. Her first book, Revolutionary Bodies, Chinese Dance and the Socialist Legacy, which was published by University of California Press in 2018, won the 2019 De La Torre Bueno Prize from the Dance Studies Association. Professor Wilcox is also co-editor with Catherine Mieser of Corporeal Politics, Dancing East Asia, which was published by the University of Michigan Press in 2020, and co-creator with Liang Yufu of the University of Michigan Asia Library Chinese Dance Collection, a wonderful collection including the Pioneers of Chinese Dance Digital Photograph Archive. So I will now pass it over to Professor Wilcox.
Thank you so much, Ariel. And I had the pleasure of visiting Ariel's class on Chinese dance dance studies earlier this week, and it was wonderful to meet her students. And I just wanna thank you for inviting me to give this talk today. I also wanna thank Connie Yip at the Center for East Asian Studies for doing a great job with all the logistics planning. And thank you all for attending today. It's wonderful to see you. I know many of us are wrapping up our semesters right now. I know at Chicago you're on the quarter system, but I really appreciate everyone who's here to listen to this talk today. So I am going to be speaking about my book, Revolutionary Bodies, Chinese Dance and the Socialist Legacy, which thanks to a grant from the Tome toward an open monograph ecosystem, I was able to publish the book open access. And so this means that it is available freely to be downloaded anywhere in the world. Another exciting component of the Luminous platform at the University of California Press, where I published the book, is that I was able to incorporate video clips in addition to photographs into the book. So there's 19 video clips that you can actually watch when you're reading the ebook, or you can click on the link, or you can scan the QR code on your phone and see the videos as you're reading. So this book is a historical investigation of a very popular dance genre called Chinese dance. And I assume that some of you are familiar with this dance form, but some may not be. And so I wanted to start by just establishing what this dance form is. So I'll show four short clips that I took while conducting fieldwork in dance conservatories in different regions of China to give you a sense of this dance form. I just realized that I forgot to share sound when I started sharing, so let me reshare. Okay. So this first clip, you can see at the top, I took it at the Beijing Dance Academy in 2018. And this is showing one of the styles of Chinese dance known as Chinese classical dance, or 中国古典舞。 And this dance form was developed on the basis of research into the movement practices of Chinese operatic theater, specifically Qin opera and Peking opera. And you can see that's been transformed pretty significantly from the opera performance stage to the dance classroom. But there are some elements of connection you can see, for example, with the use, pretty subtle use of the breath movement in the torso. There's a lot of figure eight and spiraling actions that are derived from opera movement. The hand gestures also use a lot of operatic conventions. And the overall aesthetic is one that really emphasizes the type of refined beauty, quote unquote, that is produced on the opera stage. And so it's highly gendered. This is a feminine version of the dance form. There's also a masculine version. But so this is one of the sub-styles of Chinese dance that I talk about in the book. So we'll move on to another sub-style. So as you can see, this is a clip that I took when I was doing fieldwork at the Xinjiang Arts Institute in Urumqi in 2017. So many of the styles of Chinese dance are specific to particular ethnic groups and particular regions. So this is students practicing the Uyghur classical dance style. And you can see that the costume is quite different. The entire movement vocabulary is also quite different from Chinese classical dance. Uyghur dance has much more with Central Asian dance styles like Uzbek dance, for example, and Kazakh dance. And also you can see the percussive rhythmic movement in the footwork is a very important part of the style, as well as the use of the hand gestures framing the face. This is a very common component. And if you listen to the music, of course, you can hear the use of the hand drum in addition to the vocals, and the musical styles are very specific to the different dance forms within Chinese dance as well. Another example of a sub-style of Chinese dance that is specific to a regional or an ethnic group is Mongolian dance or Mongol dance. And so this is a clip from the Inner Mongolia Arts University. And you can see here that oftentimes the dancers are accompanied by live music. And this one is played on a minzu orchestra containing a horse-headed fiddle, a flute, a drum, as well as a yangqin. So each of these dance styles has a slightly different history. When Mongol dance was first being developed in its contemporary forms, it had close connections to Western modern dance. So you see more of the floor work here, where the dancers are actually going up and down and even sitting and lying on the floor. This is a common component of Western modern dance. And one of the early founders of this form actually studied with Ichikaku in the Japanese modern dance group. Another thing that you see in Mongol dance are gestures to a specific environment. So you see a lot of gestures, such as here, where the dancers look off into the distance, as if they are conjuring up an imaginary grassland space with a distant horizon. That's a common form of Mongol dance. It's also emphasized a lot in the teaching of this dance form. You also see some elements that imitate animals that are part of the grassland department in this dance form as well. And then the last example I'll give is of what's known as Han folk dance. So this is the folk dance forms of different regions of China that are practiced or associated with the Han majority. So this is at Jilin Arts College in Northeast China, and it's specifically the Northeast Yanga dance that they're practicing here. All four of these videos are professional dance programs at universities. So these are students who are majoring in dance, and many of them will have been studying dance since they finished their primary school. Most of them will go to professional dance vocational schools and then go on to university. So these students have been studying already for many years before they get to the stage. You can tell that the musical soundscape is also specific again to this regional form. And this specific dance style of Yanga, probably many of you are familiar with, those of you who are familiar with modern Chinese history, it's a dance style that was especially promoted during the communist era as a medium for promoting the new ideological campaigns. But it takes a lot of inspiration from itinerant performances that happened at New Year celebrations, harvest celebrations. It's closely connected to rural life in China. So I hope this gives you a sense of the wide range of different dance styles that are incorporated into what we know today as Chinese dance. And also this important emphasis on the fact that this specific dance form that I'm talking about, it exists in the context of professional dance conservatories and is produced for the concert stage as an artistic practice. As I just mentioned, it includes many different substyles, but all of these what they have in common is that they all take inspiration from various local cultural materials. So as I mentioned with Chinese classical dance, they take inspiration from Chinese operatic performance. Han folk dance takes its inspiration from various types of folk performances, either among professional itinerant performers or amateurs. And then ethnic minority dance takes inspiration from different dance and performance practices, as well as historical materials from different regions and ethnic groups across China. And this is a dance form that you may know, in addition to being very widely practiced in China, is also very popular among Sinophone and diaspora communities. So there are actually numerous dance schools here in the United States that specialize in Chinese dance today. Two of the main forms that people often talk about when they talk about Chinese dance are Chinese national folk dance or Zhongguo Minzu Minjianwu, which includes Han folk dance and ethnic minority folk dance, and then Chinese classical dance, which includes the style I mentioned that's derived from operatic theater, but it also includes other substyles of Chinese classical dance. One is called the Dunhuang style, inspired by the Dunhuang Buddhist cave paintings. There's another one called the Han Tang style, which is inspired by research into historical artifacts from the Han and the Tang dynasties. Chinese dance is the most widely performed dance style in China in terms of the number of professional officially staged performances, and this includes performances by foreign touring companies. So compared to ballet and modern dance, you can see the percentages here, and this was based on a study done on all performances that happened in 2015. So this is a very, very active space of choreographic innovation in China today. There are many choreographers as well as young dancers who are practicing this form, and it is constantly developing. There's new choreographies coming out all the time. So the reason that I decided to focus on this specific dance genre in writing this book was actually in some ways in response to the lack of attention to this form in the previous English language scholarship on dance in China. So I've included some of the books here that include either a chapter or the entire book is about dance in China. And these were books that were available in English before I started writing Revolutionary Bodies. And what they all have in common is that they look at dance forms that originated in the West, such as ballet, Western modern dance, and ballroom dance. But there really wasn't an academic study looking at Chinese dance, despite the fact that it's the most widely performed dance form in China. So in order to conduct the research for this book, I actually used a very interdisciplinary approach. I was trained as an anthropologist, and so I started out using primarily an ethnographic approach. I was a visiting student at the Beijing Dance Academy, where I studied for three semesters alongside professional students in the dance academy. And primarily I studied Chinese classical dance and Chinese folk and ethnic dance. And so this laid the foundation for the research for the book in corporeal training and corporeal knowledge. And this is actually a very important methodology in dance studies. And so in this sense, this book is really crossing the fields between Asian studies and dance studies. I also became interested in the longer history of the dance forms that I was studying. And so being an ethnographer, I initially engaged with historical research through the process of oral histories. So I conducted over 200 oral histories with professional dancers of different ages and living in different regions in China to learn about their own lives and how they had first gotten into dance, the types of ensembles they had performed with, basically learning about the history of Chinese dance through each individual's own experience. Live performance is a very important component also of dance research. And so I watched, you know, hundreds of performances and continue to do so. And this is a really important and critical piece of my research practice to be able to sort of understand not only what's happening on stage, but also the social context, as well as the way in which it's being received by audiences. So there is a wide range of Chinese language scholarship about Chinese dance in the Chinese language research sphere. And there are many, many scholars based in China who work on the history of Chinese dance, as well as dancers themselves publishing their own biographies. So this gave me a rich source of secondary source material that I drew on a lot in the book and gave really important guidance. But the book itself is actually based on primary source research. So I used dance films that I was able to collect and discover dating back to the 1940s. As well as published primary sources such as newspapers, published journals and other periodicals, as well as published dancer autobiographies. And I also used extensive archival materials when they were available to be able to identify things like performance programs, as well as unpublished internally circulating documents and dancers' own personal photograph archives. So through the process of this primary source research, I put forth a new kind of historical understanding of the development of this dance form. So I argue that the dance form that we know today as Chinese dance originated in the 1940s during a period of intercultural exchange, war, and revolution. And the leading early creators of Chinese dance actually included diasporic minority and immigrant artists, many of whom are women. And this is, I think, particularly interesting given that today Chinese dance is so closely associated with national culture and nationalism. Chinese dance flourished during the early PRC era, what we call the 17 years period from 1949 to 1966, right before the emergence of the Cultural Revolution. And this was really a period when Chinese dance was the official national dance form of China. So not ballet, but Chinese dance. And so the emergence of ballet as the officially sponsored dance form of the People's Republic of China after the beginning of the Cultural Revolution in 1966 represented actually a pretty significant turn in the arts policy in China. And I'll talk more about that in a bit. By the end of the Cultural Revolution in the late 1970s, you then saw a revival of Chinese dance that occurred in the wake of this 10 years of suppression of Chinese dance in favor of ballet. And then you finally today, which is the last chapter of the book, looks at Chinese dance in the 21st century. You see the continued expansion and transformation of Chinese dance, but also you see the persistence of some often unacknowledged legacies of the socialist era. So if we think back to the period prior to the 1940s when Chinese dance first emerged, we actually can see some precursors to Chinese dance. And I talk about some of these figures briefly in the introduction, but there's a lot more to say about them. So one of them is Yu Rongling, who was the daughter of one of the ambassadors of the Qing court in the early 20th century. And she actually was able to study with Isadora Duncan, who is considered to be the founder of Western modern dance. She studied with Isadora Duncan in Paris around 1902 to 1903. And then she returned to China and performed her own choreographies, as well as some of the dance styles she had learned studying with Duncan for the Taoist the Empress Dowager, Cixi, in the Qing court. And so this was happening around 1906. This is often seen as a starting point of modern Chinese concert dance. And Yu Rongling is actually the subject of a chapter of a new book that's coming out later this year by a scholar named Nan Ma. So if you're interested in learning more, I would definitely recommend checking that book out. Mei Lanfang was another really important innovator on the stage, as I'm sure many of you are familiar. He was the most famous Peking opera star from China in the 20th century, a male performer who specialized in female roles. And as Catherine Ye, a scholar who's been doing quite a bit of research on Mei Lanfang, has really made clear recently in her scholarship, one of the main contributions of Mei Lanfang was his expansion of the role of dance in Chinese theater, and specifically the use of dance to explore and convey internal psychological content. And so many of Mei Lanfang's stage choreographies continue to be important themes that are used in Chinese dance choreography today. And then the last figure who I see as both a precursor, but later also was directly involved in the institutionalization of Chinese dance, is Wu Xiaobang. He's often known as the father of modern dance in China because he studied modern dance in Tokyo when there was a vibrant German expressionist movement happening in Tokyo in the 1930s. And he brought that back to China starting around 1935 and really made a strong effort to promote modern dance in China. even before Chinese dance, the genre that I talk about in the book, emerged in the 1940s. So in the book, I really emphasize four figures that I see as founders of the genre of Chinese dance. And this is where that really interesting diversity comes in terms of these individuals' backgrounds. So Dai Ailian, who's known as the mother of modern Chinese dance, was a third generation Chinese Trinidadian who grew up in the Caribbean. She started studying dance there in Trinidad and interestingly was the first dancer who was not white in the local ballet school. And this was a pattern that sort of followed her throughout her career in the 1930s. So she moved to England and she established herself as a professional dancer. She studied ballet and German modern dance, and she faced racism as a dancer of Asian descent, and this shaped her trajectory, as well as, of course, the outbreak of the Sino-Japanese War also shaped her trajectory in the sense that she started performing for the China Campaign Committee, which was an organization based in the UK that was raising funds to support China's war effort. And she started to develop a diaspora consciousness and an interest in China. She started creating choreographies based on Chinese themes. But at the same time, she acknowledged that she knew very little about China, you know, having grown up abroad. She didn't speak Chinese, but she had a strong desire to learn about Chinese dance and to be able to develop choreography that had more of a root in actual Chinese practices. So at the age of 24, she set sail for Asia, and she first arrived in Hong Kong. She had some high connections in her family. Her mother's second cousin was Eugene Chen, the foreign minister, who was a very close friend of Song Qingling. And so when Dai Ailian was in Hong Kong, she actually received the patronage of Song Qingling and was able to perform and gain huge audiences in Hong Kong for the year that she spent there. And then she married the Chinese painter Ye Qianyu at the end of that year. And together they moved to Chongqing, the wartime capital, and she sort of really established herself as the leading teacher of Chinese dance and then choreographer and performer in China. Khanbar Khan is a Uyghur dancer who had an interesting trajectory kind of around the same time as Dai Ailian. So she was born in Kashgar, and then her family moved to Central Asia and was actually based in Soviet Central Asia during her childhood. Her father passed away when she was quite young, and so the family, for economic reasons, you know, couldn't support itself, and that's part of why she was recruited into a dance school. So she ended up in the dance school of Tamer Khanum, who's known as the most famous early performer of modern Uzbek dance. And so Khanbar Khan was performing Uzbek dance as well as other Central Asian dance as a professional dancer after a few years. She was scouted by teachers from Moscow. She ended up being recruited to Moscow, where she spent 2 years studying Soviet dance styles, including ballet, as well as I think 16 different nationality styles. And she famously performed on stage at the Kremlin alongside Ulanova, a very famous Soviet ballerina. However, she her family still had connections in Xinjiang. And so around 1942, just a year after Dai Ailian arrived in Chongqing, Khanbar Khan moved back to Xinjiang and was based there and launched a professional dance career there and ended up becoming also, alongside Dai Ailian, one of the early leaders of this new Chinese dance movement. Cui Chengxi, or Che Seung-hee, was a Korean dancer who trained in Tokyo under Ishibaku, a modern dancer who had taken a lot of influence from the German modern dance tradition in Japan. And Che Seung-hee was initially a very, very successful modern dancer in Ishibaku's company. But in the mid-1930s, she started to create new choreography of her own that took inspiration from Korean imagery. And so this is one of the earliest pieces she did, which was a satire of the Korean intellectuals. And she developed a wide range of choreography using different types of Korean folk dance, as well as Buddhist art and imagery. And even she used shamanic performance also as a source of inspiration. She is the first dancer from East Asia to be internationally famous during this period. She, as a performer, she went on a world tour to North America, as well as Europe and Latin America. And then she returned. And like many performers in Japan at the time, she was sent to perform for the Japanese troops who at this time, of course, were stationed, many of them in China. So she ended up touring China during the early 1940s. She ended up actually staying on longer and gaining a personal interest in Chinese performing arts. She befriended Mei Lan Fang. And I'll get back to the rest of her story later, but she, even though she's Korean, she ends up playing a pretty significant role in the construction of modern Chinese dance. And the fourth figure that I see as one of these early founding figures was Liang Lun. He was born and raised in southern China. He was from Foshan in the Guangdong region. And he had to flee because of the Japanese invasions during the Sino-Japanese War. And he ended up in Kunming in southwest China. And while he was there, he was part of a larger artist and intellectual group that was interested in creating artworks to promote nationalism, but also critique the KMT government. And so this piece down on the bottom left is one of his modern dance choreographies that was critiquing the heavy inflation and poverty and starvation that was happening in the wartime conditions in Kunming. And this was created around 1945. And at the same time, he was also part of a group of students that were going to local ethnic minority communities to have dialogue and arts exchange. And he ended up creating new choreographies on the basis of e-music and dance that you can see here. Liang Lun was part of an arts group that traveled through Southeast Asia during the Chinese Civil War and promoted a lot of these new dance works as well as theater and music works to the Sinophone communities in Thailand, Malaysia, and Singapore. In addition to promoting the new Chinese performance culture among these communities, Liang also studied and created new dance works on the basis of Southeast Asian dance. So in these four figures, the reason I see them as the founding figures of modern Chinese dance is that they were the first ones to articulate a lot of the conceptual foundations of the genre, which I'll talk about in just a minute. So in their surviving writing, we see documentation of how they were formulating their approach to Chinese dance, and it very much fits with the theoretical framework that we continue to see in Chinese dance throughout the subsequent decades. But in addition to that, we also see them not only theorizing, but also creating through choreography, through stage repertoires, the first examples of Chinese dance choreography, some of which they actually perform themselves. So in terms of that theoretical foundation, in the book, I lay out what I call these three core commitments of Chinese dance that I see as really core, core theoretical ideals that practitioners of Chinese dance from the 1940s onward have sort of been committed to. So the first one is this idea of kinesthetic nationalism. So we see from very early on dancers writing about their desire to create a dance form that would be formally distinctive. So what would distinguish it as Chinese would be the dance technique itself, as opposed to the content, for example, or you know, some other artistic element. So they're really interested in the movement vocabulary as a source of an identification of national identity and local culture. And then the second one is this commitment to ethnic and spatial inclusivity. And this is really, I think, a reflection of the fact that the 1940s was a time when, of course, China was first going through the Sino-Japanese War and then going through the Civil War. And so because of this, the issue of ethnic unity became very important, but also ethnopolitics became very, very central to both the KMT and the CCP governance strategies. And so in this context, a strong emphasis on recognizing ethnic diversity as well as geographic diversity sort of became embedded into the aesthetic practice of Chinese dance going forward. And then lastly, we see a really interesting theorization of the relationship between innovation and tradition in the writings of these early dancers and also in the type of choreographic practices that they show us through their works. And this was one in which they envisioned Chinese dance innovation as something that would be heavily grounded in research, and it would be intended to sort of carry forward some kind of cultural knowledge. So it would be inheriting something, but at the same time, it would allow for change and allow for innovation in a way that was not, it was not like some of the other invented traditions where the innovation is covered up, or the innovation is not explicitly recognized. So it's an invented tradition in which the inventedness is explicit and is actually seen as a part of the practice of traditional performing arts. So I look at a lot of dancer writings in the book, in addition to analyzing the stage choreographies, because I think it's very important to understand sort of the way that the artists work theorizing their own work. And so there are a lot of dancer voices throughout the book that I bring forward. And so here's one example. So when Dai Ailian staged a very important performance in 1946 in Chongqing, this is often sort of seen by dance historians in China as one of the origin points of Chinese dance. And in the book, I really argue for it being an important origin point of the genre. So the performance is covered in the Central Daily News. There are photographs, program descriptions, but then there's also this this essay at the beginning that's always published together with the media reports about this performance. And in the essay, which is authored by Dai Ailian, she talks about her motivations for creating these choreographies. And the part that I think is interesting here is she's sort of doing a self-criticism of what she did when she first arrived in China, which was a couple of years before this. And she says that what she'd initially been doing, because she'd been trained abroad, was quote unquote, using foreign technique and footwork to tell the story, like using a foreign language to tell a Chinese tale. And she writes about how, the audience did not respond well to this. And so as a result, she really wanted to create a new movement vocabulary, a new dance language that one could say would actually be speaking in a Chinese language, or that would be what she would call Chinese dance. And so that's what she sort of calls for at the end of this essay. She calls for people to go out and do research on actually existing dance forms or other performance forms in China that could serve as the basis for this new movement form. So the example I just gave from Dai Ailian, I see as an early articulation of the kinesthetic nationalism idea. This is an interesting quote from an article that was documenting a conversation between Che Seung-hee, the Korean dancer I mentioned earlier, and Min Lanfang, the Peking opera actor that she closely befriended and also studied with. And so in this passage, Min Lanfang asks Che Seung-hee what the role of tradition is in her choreography. And she replies, "I do not completely follow inherited dances that previous people have passed down. Some say that new creation is destructive to tradition. I rather believe that new creation has always been the normal development of tradition. In the past, our ancestors' artistic creations were passed down and became today's art traditions. The new creations of today's artists will also become the traditions of future generations." And so I see this as an early articulation of the dynamic inheritance concept. So in the book, I look at specific choreographies of these dancers in order to trace the historical evolution of the dance form alongside their theoretical articulations. So this is actually the earliest recording we have of Dai Ailian choreography. It was filmed actually while she was visiting the United States in 1947, along with her husband. And this piece was based on research that she did into local performance forms when she arrived in southern China. She was traveling through Guangxi and studied with a local performer of Guizhu, the local opera form of the region. And we can definitely see, even though we don't have visual recording, we don't have videos of Dai Ailian performing in England, for example, when she was performing ballet and modern dance. We know what ballet and modern dance looked like at that time, and we can see that the type of movement vocabulary she's performing here is quite different from that. And so it shows us that she really was committed to learning from local performance styles, and that she was able to actually master some of the techniques that she was learning and adapt them into her own stage choreography. So this is a piece called The Mute Carries the Cripple that she performed very frequently in the mid-1940s. We also have this rare footage of Kambarahan, the Uyghur dancer that I mentioned. This was during a tour that she did in 1947 to 1948. This tour was organized by Zhang Zhizhong, who was military general in the Xinjiang region at the time. And she was actually performing for the nationalist government. She went to Nanjing, Shanghai. She also performed in Taipei. What's important here, I think, from a dance history perspective, is we can see some of the techniques that are today central to dance, especially Uyghur dance, performed here. She's performing dance. It's actually still taught. And so this is an early in this modern Uyghur dance style that's now incorporated into the Chinese dance, the larger Chinese style. Cheseng He also, we have some documentation of her choreography from this period where she was really building on research, as I mentioned, into various like Buddhist sculpture, for example. This is a famous piece called Bodhisattva that was reenacting you know, her own imagined interpretation of a Buddhist dance based on Buddhist artwork. She also, as I mentioned before, this piece based on shamanic performance, and these are all dances that she toured in China that also shaped the development of Chinese dance in the 1940s. This is a piece that, so she started to branch out and create choreography on Chinese and Japanese themes as well, in addition to Korean themes, and that was a Chinese themed work that we just saw. And then she also developed quite a few dances that were based on Korean musical practices as well as fan dance. So later in her life, she actually settled in North Korea and became one of the main leaders of the North Korean dance movement. And this is what this film is from. So in these examples, we see the artists sort of creating choreography as well as publishing theoretical articulations of what they're doing. And what unites all of them is this idea that they want to create a new dance form that's taking inspiration from local performance practices, local performance traditions, but revising it for the contemporary moment to meet the needs of, you know, whatever the contemporary political issues are, but also to meet the needs of a staged concert dance practice. So this is happening sort of in these parts of China, not really in concert with one another. Of course, there was a certain amount of information circulating between different regions of China, but they weren't really seeing each other's performances live. It wasn't until 1949 that many of these dancers were recruited to join forces and start to establish national dance institutions, for example, and choreographies sort of that they worked on collectively. At the same time, you had artists coming from the communist areas of China that were bringing in the new Yanga experiments. And so all of these artists sort of started to collaborate and create the new Chinese dance form in the context of the early PRC. So in chapter two of the book, I look at some of the early choreographies that they created and really show that there was a period of experimentation when the, it was not clear, there was not a clear top-down instruction of Chinese dance should look like, but instead you had people sort of trying out different things that they'd already created, blending it together. So you have this piece, Long Live the People's Victory from 1949, where you definitely see Yanga, you definitely see these materials that had been taken from, at the time it was known as frontier dance. So what Dai Ailin, Kambarahan, and Liangluan were doing. You see that kind of blended together into this national pageant. But you also see in 1950, this piece called Peace Dove, which was primarily ballet with a little bit of modern dance mixed in. This is actually Dai Ailin performing ballet here and on point. And it was a piece about the international peace movement. And you know, it ended up being highly criticized, but it helped to move forward the critical discourse about Chinese dance period. And alongside that, you then had these quite realistic depictions of the recent military battles that were being staged as full-length dance dramas, in which the dancers actually conducted field research, they interviewed soldiers, they tried to experience like the battle sites and then turn that into a stage production. So these were some of the early examples of Chinese dance choreography happening in the first years of the PRC. But really what came out in the critical reflections of those early works was that there was a lack of trained dancers. There wasn't really professional dance training in China, except for in some of the foreign established dance schools in places like Shanghai, Harbin, and Tianjin. And so this idea was put forth that, you know, in order to have a Chinese dance genre, we need to have trained dancers. And so this is actually the moment that Kambarahan and Cheseng He come back into the picture, because they both end up in Beijing touring as parts of different projects. And so they get recruited to actually help train the first generation of Chinese dance performer. Kambarahan is, is hired or sort of promoted to lead this dance program at the Ethnic Minority Northwest Art Academy Ethnic Minority Arts Program. And she recruits a really diverse range of dance students from different ethnic backgrounds, and they become this first generation of trained dancers in the Western areas of China. At the same time, you have Che Seung-hee, who gets invited to teach an important class at the Central Academy of Drama, where students are recruited from all over China, and they come to study with her. And through this process, she actually develops the first curriculum for Chinese classical dance. A couple of years after this, you have the establishment of the first national dance school, which creates the first standardized national dance curriculum for China. So the Beijing Dance School had two programs. It had a program in ballet and it had a program in Chinese dance. And the Chinese dance program included Chinese classical dance, which was really the focus of the training, but it also had required courses in Han folk dance and ethnic minority dance. And in the early stages, it's taught three styles of ethnic minority dance, Uyghur, Korean, and Tibetan. You had the establishment of national dance ensembles soon after this. So as soon as the first generations of students graduated, they joined these ensembles, as well as some dancers who'd sort of been working in the wartime performance ensembles were recruited to perform in these ensembles. So the first three that were established, Central Song and Dance Ensemble, Nationality Song and Dance Ensemble, and China Opera and Dance Drama Theater, were all completely dedicated to performing Chinese dance. The next one that was established was the Oriental Song and Dance Ensemble, which specialized in dances of Asia, Africa, and Latin America. And then you have the Central Ballet of China, which was established within the Beijing Dance School as an affiliated ensemble in 1959, and then became an independent ensemble in 1964. But what I think this shows us is that the emphasis in these national ensembles was really on Chinese dance choreography and performance. So, you know, I think the history and PRC cultural studies has really opened our eyes, I would say, over the past two decades to the wide range of transnational exchange that was happening in Maoist China. So as cultural studies scholars, I think, you know, we no longer see the Maoist era or the socialist era in China as a time of isolation. And I definitely, in my book, I contribute to this, this new understanding of the transnational connections that were happening in the socialist period. In chapter three, when I look at the international circulation of Chinese dance during the 1950s and early 60s. And so one of the archival sources that I use here is the sources from the World Festivals of Youth and Students, which you can see here, they took place roughly every 2 to 3 years, primarily in Eastern Europe. So these are really fascinating events that have, you know, they're multifaceted, and the archive in Amsterdam is very rich, but I focus specifically on the role of dance in these events. And so dance ensembles were actually often sent as part of the youth delegations from different countries. And there was a huge emphasis on folk dance and ethnic and nationality dance, which of course Chinese dance perfectly fit into that larger global trend that was happening among leftist youth organizations that was really featured. And so the festival actually had dance competitions where different countries could win awards for their dance choreography. And China was one of the most prominent countries in those dance competitions. So these are some examples from the archival documentation where we see sort of reporting on Chinese dance ensembles at these festivals. You can see it in this poster, which is also in the archive. This is from the 1957 festival in Moscow. So you have dancers and musicians representing different parts of the world. And the one here in the top right is actually from this really famous choreography called the Chinese, the Red Silk Dance, or the Chinese Ribbon Dance, as it's sometimes translated. So I talk about how this piece of choreography came about, and in many ways it's quite emblematic of the choreographic strategies that became sort of the model for how to create Chinese dance during this period. So this piece was first created by a regional performing arts ensemble in Changchun in Northeast China. According to their own sort of account of the creative process, they studied with local opera performers, as well as renjuan performers, which is a kind of local comedy duet, as well as yanga performers, the Han folk dance, and they blended them together into this new choreography. And then the choreography was very successful. It was selected to be performed at a national festival in 1951. And then it sort of became very, very widely known on the national stage. And then it was sent abroad to represent China in the international stage. So it became widely known outside China as well. This piece is interesting because, as you can see, the costuming is meant to convey a rural aesthetic. So the figures that are representing the Chinese nation here are peasants, right? And in the Chinese socialist ideology, it's like peasants, soldiers, and workers. And so we have the peasant here sort of embodied on stage in a very deliberate way. But at the same time, they're using this this prop of this long ribbon in order to create a very festive atmosphere. And the music is clearly drawn from sort of festival folk music. But it's also, of course, works really well in the international leftist world as a symbol of communism as well. So we have these multi-layered elements of the choreography that that are making this piece so successful and iconic. And so this is a recording from 1963. The piece continued to be very widely performed for more than a decade. At the same time, we see the reflection of sort of that second core commitment that I mentioned, that emphasis on ethnic and regional or geographic diversity was very present in the repertoires of this period. So this is a piece that was widely circulated both inside China and also outside China. So like Red Silk Dance, it was sent to the World Youth Festivals. It won an award at the World Youth Festival in 1957. This is a piece that is representing the Tibetan nationality in China, and it's bringing together different styles of Tibetan performing arts into this one choreography. But interestingly, this piece was actually co-choreographed, and one of the choreographers was a Tibetan performer who had been recruited to become a member of the Nationality Song and Dance Ensemble in Beijing, the Music Go. So it's a piece that incorporated, actually this dancer here was also, he's a ethnically Miao dancer. So there were a lot of ethnic minority dancers in the piece, and there was some participation by Tibetan choreographers in the creation of the piece as well. This is another example of a very, very iconic work from this period. It's called Chunjiang Hua Yue Ye, right? So it takes inspiration from classical poetry. And it's one of the earliest pieces in the Chinese classical dance repertoire that was circulating widely during the early socialist era. I really like this piece because I think it causes us to challenge and open up our notions of socialist femininity, to think that this was actually representing Chinese socialist culture, both domestically and internationally in the late 50s and early 60s, the very moment of the rise of the Iron Woman, right, in a lot of Chinese visual culture. So by looking at those are examples of dances we have that are recorded on dance films that were produced in the late 50s and early 60s. We also have documentations of the specific programs that were sent abroad. So this is one from 1960 of a tour that was sent to Cuba and I believe Colombia. And so these tours of Chinese dance were actually sent to many, many countries during this period. So this is just a map showing the different countries where Chinese dance ensembles toured between 1949 and 1965. At the same time, once these new choreographies became really well received and were sort of seen as iconic, canonical works, they were then promoted domestically through a variety of methods. And one of the methods was these dance manuals, which we also have. We have quite a few of these in our dance collection at the University of Michigan that really have a lot of rich information in them because they are meant to teach people how to perform the dances. So they have a lot of detailed technical information. So at the end of chapter three, I look at this really important way that Chinese dance was choreographed starting in the late 50s and continues to be the most sort of large scale, resource intensive, but also from a dancer's perspective, sort of seen as sort of the ultimate expression of Chinese dance choreography, which is the national dance drama. So these are full length narrative choreographies in which an entire story unfolds on stage, just using dance. So there's no dialogue typically. And we have full length film recordings of three of these dance dramas from the late 50s and early 60s. And so I look at these in the book, and specifically I'm interested in how these choreographies, of course, were conveying specific ideological and political themes at the time. But they were doing that through these aesthetic practices that were very much interested in presenting traditional or local indigenous aesthetics in contrast to a type of ballet or Western aesthetic. So Magic Lotus Lantern is considered to be the first full-length Chinese classical dance drama. It takes this famous story of an immortal named San Sheng Mu, who falls in love with a human. And in the context of Chinese socialist art practice, this was actually promoted as a story about free marriage and a story about, you know, promoting the new marriage law and the new idea of equality between men and women. And so it's about their struggle to be together despite the fact that as an immortal and a human, you know, they're not supposed to. So it's a love story. We also see this an example of another kind of political theme here, which is the Dagger Society. This real historical event that happened in the 1850s is being restaged as a way to talk about Chinese peasant rebellion as something that dates back to the era of the Opium Wars. And so the narrative here is actually, it's about a group of local peasants who rise up to revolt against this colonial figure who's like, this is scene he's shown here, importing opium on the backs of Chinese workers. And it has sort of anti-Qing critique too. It's critiquing the corrupt officials who worked with the foreign imperialists. And in the 1959, this was actually talked about as really being about the anti-imperialist, anti-colonial project of support international. So there's a lot to analyze in these pieces, and I won't go through in detail here. But the other full-length film that we have from this period that shows an entire full-length dance drama is Five Red Pages, with issues of including members of the community. This is out, but it really is talking about that look at the interest of that. We thematize that in this way. We see the continued development of new forms of Chinese dance choreography in the mid-1960s. So for example, you start to see works like The East is Red, probably something that's well known to many of you. We see this create much larger scale, especially group choreography. And we see the incorporation of what's interesting here is many of the choreographic segments of this piece using the new dance choreography. So this is based on a Han dance choreography that in the 1950s. And so the U are international we also see the emergence of new choreography created by Chinese dancers, but using themes of international revolutionary issues. So this American Civil War. And it's actually about brutality in the American context. So again, topic analysis here, but I won't go into it. In the mid-1960s, we also see the emergence of women, especially women. This piece, I think, is pretty interesting because it's not in the same as the red detachment of women. But whereas red detachment of women uses a ballet technique as the movement choreography, this piece actually uses movement forms from Chinese classical dance to portray a kind of similar image of the female militia. So we can argue in terms of the book that there was really a wide kind of diversity of dance practices happening in the mid-1960s. So it's at the same time that we see the emergence of the revolutionary ballets, which were also made into films. And so we have this really wonderful, you know, documentation of the choreography that we can look at. And so in chapter four, I talk about the history of ballet in China. And really, one of the things I emphasize is that ballet was introduced to China actually prior to the socialist era. So we often have the misconception that it was introduced by the Soviets, but in fact, it was introduced by the white Russians, the people who fled the Soviet Union, who ended up in places like Shanghai and Harbin. So I talk about like Hu Rongrong, this ballerina who had been trained in Shanghai and performed in films, and she performed in these full-length ballets in the late 1940s. In the 50s, then we do see the arrival of the Soviet ballet teachers, and they initially staged, you know, the classics like Swan Lake, for example. And it's not until we see other countries performing revolutionary ballets in China that we see the introduction of more of these modern themed ballets. So we have the Matsuyama Ballet of Japan that comes and tours the first ballet version of The White-Haired Girl in 1958. We have the National Ballet of Cuba. And then you start to see ballet companies in China also staging some of the modern Soviet ballets around the same time. And this leads to, of course, the emergence of the revolutionary ballets in China. So one of the things I emphasize in the book is that the Cultural Revolution was quite destructive to the Chinese dance practices that were ascendant in the 1950s and early 60s. So many of the leading figures of the Chinese dance world, you know, like the leading figures of so many other arts and intellectual communities, were personally attacked and were not permitted to practice their art forms. And most of the Chinese dance choreography, even things like East is Red, were not allowed to be performed during this period. And so this led to, you know, the suppression of Chinese dance, but then ultimately a very vibrant revival in the late 1970s. So in chapter five, I chronicle these two pieces that came out that really shaped new styles of Chinese dance. So one was this piece called Zhao Shu Tun Nan Mo Nona, which was the Peacock Princess. And it's actually starring Yang Liping, who, for those of you who are familiar with Chinese dance, know, I mean, she is the most famous choreographer and dancer in China today. And many don't realize that she actually launched her career in 1978 with this, this role. She was only 19 at the time, but this role as the Peacock Princess in this full-length dance drama that was performed by Xichuang Bana Song and Dance Ensemble. And it toured in Beijing as part of a national festival. The other piece from this period that was very influential was called Flowers and Rain on the Silk Road. It's the first full-length dance drama that's using the Dunhuang style of Chinese classical dance, and I'll talk about that more in a minute. So this is a clip from a 1980 clip from this dance drama, Flowers and Rain on the Silk Road, where we can see how so this was created by the Gansu Song and Dance Ensemble from Lanzhou, and they spent years studying the choreography in the cave paintings in Dunhuang and basically transformed the images that they found in the still paintings into a movement, an actual movement vocabulary. So they blended them together into a dance style that became the basis for the dancing in this piece. And so that's why this piece was so influential, because it introduced an entirely new dance technique that was based on the Buddhist painting. One of the things I argue in this chapter is sort of the way in which the late 70s, the early 80s, we often see it because it was a rejection of the Cultural Revolution. You know, many people like Jeremy Barmé and others call it a period of deep Maoification. But interestingly, in the dance field, we actually see a continuation of projects that had started in the 1950s that were discontinued during the Cultural Revolution, but then this was sort of their return. So with Dunhuang dance, for example, we see early examples of experimentation with Dunhuang imagery in the 1950s. This is just one example of a choreography by Dai Ailian in 1955. And then I argue something similar with Yang Liping's Peacock dance. So this is probably a piece that's very familiar to many, widely performed today. This is Yang Liping's Peacock dance solo. It won awards. Awards in 1956, to an even higher level of stardom at that point. The foundation for an entire style of Dai peacock dance that continues widely from China and internationally. And so I trace the development of this peacock dance actually also back to the 1950s. So this is a 1956 peacock dance drama that was also created by the Xichuang Bana Ensemble. There's also this really fun children's film from 1963 that's about the Peacock Princess story that has claymation figures doing peacock dances. And so I look at, there's actually interesting parallels in the choreography between the dance scenes in this children's film and the choreography that we see Yang Liping perform in the 1980s. And so I argue through the analysis of the choreographic continuities that there really was this socialist continuity that was happening. So things that we saw in the late 70s and early 80s that many saw as new were actually continuations of some of these practices that had been happening in the regional performance offices. We have one now, right? And they emerged on the national stage in the revolution era and then got woven into the national dance. So these are just examples of performance posters of these works that are still continuing to be revived and continuing to be performed in the 21st century. So in the last chapter, I really focus on Chinese dance in the 21st century. So I look at some of the younger dancers today who are in the forefront of Chinese dance choreography and performance. And I think about the ways in which they are continuing to adapt this dance style to new contexts, new sort of political, ideological messages, and then also new choreographic experiments. So here we see Gulmira Mehmet, who is a star in the Xinjiang dance scene right now. She won one of the first seasons of So You Think You Can Dance China. And so we see her here performing on stage in a dance television competition, and she's performing a Uyghur dance choreography. If we compare it in our mind's eye to that film I showed of Kambar Han from 1947, we see some shared elements, but of course the speed is much faster. Those fast spins and sort of in general, the movement choreography is so much more adapted to a contemporary kind of television audience expectation for the performing arts today. So I see this as an embodied example of the dynamic inheritance that's continuing in the current moment. Gulmira is a direct descendant of Kambar Han in terms of artistic genealogy. So she was trained by students of Kambar Han in the dance program that Kambar Han had established at the Xinjiang Arts Institute. I also look at the ways in which narrative choreography, especially full-length dance dramas, is continuing to engage contemporary political issues in China. So this was a piece that was created using the Yanga aesthetic to commemorate the sort of, I forget exactly, it was like such and such an anniversary of the Yan'an talks or of the founding of the PRC. So we frequently have these performance events that are commemorating socialist history. And they're actually using the socialist dance choreographies explicitly as part of that commemoration. We also have works like this, Maritime Silk Road, that are actually promoting the new Belt and Road Initiative through choreography. So here we have it's a story about a Chinese merchant who sails and ends up in what is now Sri Lanka, ends up making friends with the local community. And it's really about sort of this international exchange and friendship that can develop between Belt and Road members. And this came out right at the moment when one of the first large container ports that was invested by China was actually being established in Sri Lanka. So it's very closely tied to the contemporary political issues. Watch a little bit of this one. This one is, it's kind of in the category of what I talk about in the book at a really popular oriented stage choreography in China. So it has these kind of dance works have huge audiences in China. That are in part created through these star performers, but are also in part created through the star choreographer. So the choreographer of this piece was also one of the choreographers for the Beijing Olympic opening ceremony. They really integrated a lot of interesting, not only dance technique, but also stage technology. So here they used the projection on a screen to create an underwater swimming scene. There's a lot of emphasis on sort of innovation choreography as well as innovation. And then lastly, at the very end of the book, I look at the ways in which the relationship between the contemporary artist and the past is really being rethought and reflected on in contemporary choreography. So I look at this piece from 2000, the solo Chinese classical dance work, which is actually adapted from a 1997 Hong Kong novel. So we have an expansion in the type of source material that can be considered legitimate inspiration for classical dance works. And even the types of images are also really being challenged. So here we have the main character in the story is a prostitute, and she is now performing in this piece. And there was a lot of debate as to whether this figure could really represent quote unquote classical Chinese culture. So dance critics were at first kind of skeptical about this, but the piece ended up being very successful and really widened the scope of what could be addressed in the context of a Chinese classical dance choreography. Lastly, I talk about this work, Fat Tongue Thin Song, which is really using the minimalist stage aesthetic that we often see in European dance theater. But it's using that aesthetic to actually reflect on new ways of thinking about history and new ways of thinking about how to stage history through dance choreography. And this piece is sort of taking a very impressionistic approach to representing the Tang and the Song dynasties. And it's using a lot of Tang and Song poetry to do that. But it's also using sort of interesting ways of staging relationships between choreographers and the material that they're working with. So in this opening scene of the piece, we have who's facing back to the audience, who is kind of a figure representing some of the painters who went into Dunhuang in the 1940s and first kind of captured some of the their own modern paintings that went then circulated. So he's staging this like imagined interaction between this dancer and the painting, right? This woman in the painting was coming to life. And then he walks away and the rest of the piece is sort of her story or sort of her place in history. And it's very, very abstract, which makes it quite from a lot of the more narrative realistic dance dramas that prior to this had been sort of the main thing for Chinese classical dance. So that's all, I'll end here. And I really look forward to your questions and comments. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Emily, for that wonderfully rich talk. We do have a number of questions already, and if other people want to add their questions, please do so in the Q&A chat box. So our first question is from Meishan Zhang, who writes, many of the examples you cite are from universities and stages. I guess these dance teachings are very academic, focusing on technique and performance. To what extent can these academic dances represent the original and traditional cultures, especially the dances in everyday and daily life and festivals of ethnic minorities?
Yeah, that's such a great question. So I would say that's exactly the question that that these academic dance practitioners and professional dance practitioners and ensembles are really grappling with throughout this period. So as I mentioned, one of the things that these dance forms share is that they're really interested in conducting research. So going back to Dai Island and even Kambara Han, they talk about how they really made a lot of effort to study with local folk artists, to conduct field work, to conduct historical research. So this idea of conducting research is seen as sort of the ideal way that a choreographer will maintain some kind of authenticity or some kind of representation of actually existing forms or actually existing, ethnic minority forms or historical forms. But at the same time, because of the dynamic inheritance imperative that I talked about, they don't see themselves as trying to perfectly replicate that on stage. And so they see themselves as being a conduit. And literally they use the word of seeing themselves as a bridge between the folk and the stage. And so the idea is that they want to make, to keep enough of the folkloric practice present for it to still be reflective of something original. But they want to adapt it enough that contemporary audiences in urban settings will appreciate it and enjoy it. And so they see their role as sort of translating it for an audience so that it can maintain enough to still have some kind of original substance, but also be appealing enough that it can continue to be carried forward. And so most of the choreographers and writers and dance critics will really make a distinction between folk forms and ethnic minority forms and historical forms sort of actually existing in whatever environment they come from or exist in. And they will see that as sort of a separate trajectory from the work that they're doing, which is putting that on stage. And so ideally, both of those forms will exist simultaneously, and the stage will kind of help to build interest in those other forms, which then hopefully people will also be able to gain access to or at least appreciate. The idea is not to replace them, and the idea is definitely not to be able to fully convey them. And so I think the question that you're asking sort of gets actually at the heart of some of the main artistic and theoretical issues that they're grappling with.
Great. And Meishan had what I guess is something of a follow-up to that about the movement between these two spheres potentially. About the policies that are in place, about what is, what parts of traditional dances, quote unquote, should be kept and admitted, such as certain elements that do not conform to socialist values and modern moral principles.
Absolutely. So with theater, there was the constant, practices of reform in dance. So at certain times in history, like the erotic components would be downplayed or components being discriminatory towards the poor or discriminatory towards women or towards certain groups and communities that the socialist government did not want to be discriminated against, right? Those would be taken out, right? Or there are other themes, right, that would be taken out at different periods depending on the needs of the political issues of the agendas of the time. And so that's constantly shifting, and it's something that choreographers are sensitive to, but at the same time cannot always predict. And so they still go through the process of shincha, you know, the process where they have to do some kind of rehearsal, and then the local officials have to come in and give feedback, and then they have to adjust based on that feedback. And that's still very much part of the choreographic process.
Great. So our next question is from Catherine Muser, and she asks, you mentioned training throughout the presentation, and I wondered about how these physical methods reflected any focus on training for a particular type of body. In any of these forms or comments by dancers, is there an ideal body type that is promoted by not only training certain movements and sequences, but also a selection of dancer processes that only selected certain body types, like, for example, the ballet body type? And was there a subtle racism towards a certain type of body?
Absolutely. Yeah. So hi, Catherine. Nice to see you. So one of the things I talked about a lot in my dissertation, which is very different from the book. If people are interested, there's a lot in the dissertation about this topic. So there's a very rigorous selection process that dancers in China go through. And definitely in the professional dance schools, there is a very clear, unapologetic idea that there is a specific dancer's body. Only people with that body should be dancing. And it's you know, there's no kind of like effort to even really qualify that, with the exception of some program. So if it's a choreography program, you'll see students with different body types. If it's a performance program, most of the dancers have a very similar body type, which is long legs, very, very thin, a long arm, small head. It's very defined what they're looking for. And they actually get measured as part of the testing process. And so, and so that does create an expectation for what a dancer's body should look like. It creates aesthetic ideas about what's beautiful, and also what you know cannot appear on stage. There's a little bit more variety or sort of flexibility in Chinese folk dance recruitment, where you see that kind of really emphasis on that really strict idea of a body type is in Chinese classical dance, especially. That has like the most rigorous standards, all of this reflects like ideas about beauty, ideas about race for sure, and gender as well.
Great, thank you. Actually, if I could ask a quick follow-up, it sounded like the body that you described is very much a traditional ballet body. Is there some sort of distance between the ideal classical Chinese dancer's body and the ballet body in the, you know, proportion of the torso to the legs or that sort of stuff?
I think it's very similar because when the Beijing Dance School was being established, they did have a Soviet ballet instructor there who was helping with the recruitment process. And she had a large role in developing like the initial sort of rules for the recruitment. And so I think it's very similar to the ballet body type. And I would say that one of the only maybe perhaps differences is there's more of an emphasis on back flexibility for the female dancers in Chinese classical dance that you don't see as much in ballet being emphasized as like a qualification.
Great. So we have a question here about the historical and perhaps contemporary cross influence and collaborations between Chinese dance and American dance.
So they want to know about these collaborations? Sorry, I'm not reading the questions.
Yeah, no, it just sounds like about the historical and maybe also contemporary cross influence and collaborations between Chinese dance and American dance. I'm not quite sure. If that attendee wants to maybe specify, do they mean like American vernacular dance forms?
Or a little bit. So there are some interesting, so I mentioned like Yu Rongling studied with Isadora Duncan, who was like an early American modern dance, right? So there's these individual relationships that exist. Some of the Japanese dancers that Wu Xiaobang studied with also, I think direct or indirect engagement with Isadora Duncan and some of her dance. So there's like an American modern dance kind of connection through Japan and then through Xiaobang and also through Ibaku, who trained Che Sing Hee and who also trained Jia Zuoguang, who was one of the early Mongolian dance choreographers. There were also some American dancers like teaching in, we talked about this on Monday actually, but teaching in some of the women's schools in China in the 1920s and 30s, you had women, you had especially women from like women's American modern dance to China, not necessarily to professional dancers, but to students in those schools who did go on to in some way shape the dance world in China. And then you had the individual dancers like Sophia Delza, who was a modern dancer from New York. She was in Shanghai in 1950, and she was teaching modern dance and like lecturing on modern dance. And some of the people that I later interviewed had like taken her classes and had been influenced by her, but there's not much written about her specific time in China. But then of course, the most obvious example, there's two. So one is, there was a Chinese dancer who had been in the US from 1940s up until 1957. And he had studied with Ellen Nicolai, who's an American modern dance choreographer. And then he went back to China in 1957. He tried to implement American modern dance into the Chinese curriculum. It was rejected, but there was like a public debate about it in the Chinese writings that you can like find. They're really interesting to read in terms of the reasons for rejecting it. But then that dancer like stayed in China, and in the post-cultural revolution era, he started promoting ballroom dance and like disco dance and different types of American social dance forms. So he continued sort of to try to promote American dance in various ways and went more the popular route later on. But then the most famous example is the American Dance Festival in the late 1980s. They actually sponsored a program in modern dance at the Guangzhou School. And it was also collaborating with the Beijing Dance Academy. And they trained like the first really serious generation of American modern dance technique into dancers in China. And then they went to found the Guangdong Modern Dance Company. And sort of that's an entire story that there's another book coming out that's about like that whole exchange by Professor Fang Fei Miao. So you can look forward to that if you're interested in learning more.
Great. So we have a question about how you would situate the touring Shenyun performances in the world of Chinese dance.
Yes, thank you for asking about that, because it causes so much confusion, because not only because it's like doing what it's doing, but also because one of the major styles of Chinese classical dance is called Shenyun, right? Which is a different Chinese character, but it sounds the same as Shenyun. One is body and one is spirit, right? And so people get confused about this all the time. So Shenyun, the American-based Shenyun company that probably people have seen all the posters, is an anti-China group that is affiliated with the Falun Gong, you know, the religious group that's banned in China. It's, you know, very controversial. So they are explicitly using Chinese dance to promote an anti-China message in the United States. They're based in the United States and they're promoting it to, you know, international audiences. And so many people see those performances. What's interesting is they have this whole narrative. They claim that Chinese dance was banned in the socialist period, and so they're reviving it from like ancient times. But it's hilarious because the dances that they're performing were actually constructed during the early socialist period with the official support of the communist government. So it's very ironic, and you know, in some ways it's helping because more people are seeing different types of Chinese dance, but then also interestingly, because the Chinese government doesn't want them dominating the narrative, the Chinese government is now sending more Chinese dance choreography to the United States. And so more people are able to see Chinese dance choreography in some ways as a result of this. But yeah, good question.
Thanks. Let's see, so we have a question about the revival of revolutionary dances in recent years. Revolutionary ballets like Hongzhi and Yangtze Jun are more frequently performed than before. Do you think it is also a continuity of the past, or are there some new messages to convey? There are changes of appearances and gestures of the dancers too.
This is also super interesting. So there was just a book written. It was published in Chinese by a dance anthropologist in China. And it's exactly investigating this issue of what's new about the revivals of the revolutionary ballets that are being performed today. And she interviews a lot of the younger dancers who are performing in these roles, but who have no personal experience of the revolutionary era. And so I haven't looked into that as much because it's not my area of interest, but I think what I would say is that, you know, I've watched the 1971 films and compared them with the contemporary stage productions, and there definitely are differences in the choreography, but into the fact that there's a difference in the way that the dancers perform. And also because of what we were talking about earlier in terms of the way that dancers' bodies are selected, the dancers themselves physically look different now than they did in the 1960s. They're much thinner. They don't have the same kind of like gravitas, in my opinion. And also they're not performing it. They're performing it through distance, right? They're not actually embodying these values. And so it feels, I think, very different, although it's still quite powerful to see on stage. But yeah, I think there's a whole set of interesting questions about why they're becoming more popular now and sort of who the audiences are. I've heard many of the audiences for those works are often people who are like in the diaspora, who have direct memories of the Cultural Revolution. And so in a way it's sort of going back to memories of their home, you know, childhood and things like that. So actually I have a PhD student who's interested in researching that for her dissertation. And so I think hopefully there'll be really interesting research coming out in the future.
Great, thanks. Okay, so we have a question from Tin Yun Hua that says, I have a question about Wen Gong Chuan, the military unit, but also focuses on art and performance, and dancing is an important part in it, if not the most important. What is the origin of such organization? Do they have any relation to the new dance movement you mentioned earlier? How do you read this combination of military organization and dancing practice, maybe also the ideology and the body?
Yes, this is such a wonderful question. And I'm actually thinking of writing a book about the Wen Gong Tuan because they're so central to the performing arts in China. And as I think probably the person who asked the question knows, they represent this entire style of dance, military dance in China, which is also known as contemporary dance in China, which all these like interesting issues for dance, you know, writers who don't know what word to use to translate contemporary dance in China when it actually means military dance. But it's a really fascinating genre of dance in China that is intertwined with Chinese dance. And so, for example, the Five Red Clouds piece, the full-length dance drama that I mentioned from 1959 that was staging ethnic tensions alongside class tensions. It's actually the image that's on the cover of my book. That piece was created by one of the Wen Gong Tuan. It was by a military ensemble. So some of the really like canonical works of Chinese dance were actually staged by the Wen Gong Tuan and by the military stream ensembles. So they were producing a lot of, they still, you know, up until the present, they're still continuing to produce important works of Chinese dance choreography, although sadly, most of them have been closed in like the last 3 years because there's been this shift in the military to take money away from arts performance and invest it more in like technology and other types of military, weaponry. So a lot of the troops have been closed down, but traditionally, as maybe many of the audience members know, the military ensembles were highly revered and seen to be some of the best performing arts ensembles in the country, like, Zhongzheng Gouwu Tuan is like full of stars, basically, not only dancers, but also musicians and singers. And the choreography that they created was also very interesting. So that piece I showed that was about the American Civil Rights Movement from 1964, that was about the police brutality, that was created by one of the military ensembles. So they tended to take up obviously more realistic and military connected themes. And so that choreography I find to be really fascinating to analyze, but it's also really interesting, like in more contemporary, like when I was doing field work in China at the Beijing Dance Academy in 2008, 2009, you had a lot of really interesting contemporary dance choreography coming out of the military dance programs that was in some ways more similar to like European contemporary dance, even than when you would see in like the modern dance companies in China. So I think there's a lot there to unpack and investigate in terms of what those ensembles contributed to the dance field in China. But I definitely think that I agree with you that they're like very worth investigating.
Okay, so we have a question about viral videos, about that very cute evening banquet in the Tang Palace piece that went viral from the Spring Festival Gala, one of the regional ones from the past year. So it's very popular amongst Gen Z. What is your opinion on this trend of China's traditional dance becoming recognized by Chinese, the teenage community, gaining all these new, I guess, like TikTok?
Can someone, the person who put that question, put the link to the piece in the, I just want to make sure
it's where they're, you know, that the painting, the famous, where they're, I think the one that they're referencing, the most recent iteration, they have all these sort of like video projections where they're in a museum and they all have like cotton in their mouth. And it's this very like comic, charming piece.
So. I would love to see it. Occasionally my students will send me stuff like that. I mean, I think it's great. I think it's great that people are interested in it and, you know, then they want to perform it. And even if it's dance choreography, I think it's that it's getting more of the end. People are interested in that, as you know, that kind of question about, you know, court dance in ancient China. If it gets them interested in that, I think that's great. And yeah, I've seen other examples that have gone viral like that, so I'm not surprised, but I don't know. I have to see it to be able to see more, I think.
Okay. Let's see. So we have a lot of questions that we'll try to get to as many as possible before we have to end in a few minutes. Let's see. We have a question about the possible narrowness of the Chinese classical dance. So given that Chinese classical dance is an invented tradition, what are the implications for popular understandings of Chinese tradition and the past, both domestically and internationally? Is it contributing to a narrowing vision of Chineseness? Mm-hmm. And then maybe this other question might somewhat go with it. I don't know if you want to answer them in tandem, but it's a question about changes in the last few years where dancers may be less open to talking critically about dancing or training or anything related to the party. So I guess one is sort of the kind of you know, projection outwards of a particular kind of Chineseness and how narrowing that may or may not be. And then sort of, I guess, internal to either the sort of dance academy or dancers themselves being able to criticize the, you know, what constitutes classical Chinese dance in the sort of contemporary moment.
Yeah, I think these are really great questions. I mean, one of the things that really attracted me to Chinese classical dance initially was that there was so much debate in that field. It's like one of the most contentious fields for sure in the entire dance world in China. And it has to do with the fact that there's debates over what Chineseness should be that are constantly happening. And so that's why you have, I mentioned there's multiple different styles of Chinese classical dance that are sort of competing with each other to define Chineseness. So there's the one that's rooted in the opera movement. And then there's one that was basically created to critique the opera movement one, and the founder of the field, the one that's critiquing it is called Hantang Chinese classical dance. And the founder, Sun Ying, was like vehemently opposed to the idea that opera movement should represent Chinese culture because he felt that it emerged in like what he called the era of bound feet, you know, during the, you know, after the 10th century. And he thinks that the part prior to that of Chinese history, the Han and the Tang, is like more representative to him of what Chinese culture should be. So he created an entire dance style that's very widely performed today that was meant to combat that. And then you see the Dunhuang style emerge that's more rooted in Buddhist iconography. So I think that the style itself, it creates the possibility for constantly new interpretations of Chinese classical culture. And that was something I talked about a little bit at the end of the talk, right? Where you get this adaptation of the Hong Kong novel, Yan Zhi Ko, being presented as Chinese classical dance. And so there is a space within the structure that allows for the new interpretations, in my opinion.
Great, thank you. So we're about out of time in terms of questions. But Professor Wilcox will receive a copy of them, and so she'll have a chance to look at them. But thank you all for submitting questions today. And thank you all for joining us this evening. A very special thanks to our guest speaker tonight, Professor Wilcox, for such a wonderful and rich presentation. We hope that you all enjoyed tonight's program. As a reminder, if you're interested in learning more about upcoming events hosted by the Center for East Asian Studies here at the University of Chicago, please click on the links being provided again in the chat box. We also encourage you to subscribe to CEAS emails so that you can receive up-to-date information on future virtual events related to East Asia. Again, thank you all for attending tonight's program, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of your evening. Thank you. Bye.